Krishnanan, and in this session, we are going to learn about earthquakes. So what is an earthquake? How does it occur? And why this frequency of earthquake is increasing day by day? Every day in news, you'll find that some place has experienced certain level of earthquake. So what is happening all about it? So in this session, we are going to learn about all the details related to earthquakes. But before we go ahead, please like and subscribe to my channel and please press the bell icon for the updates.
So the first question, what is an earthquake? So earthquake is basically shaking or trembling of the earth's surface due to seismic waves. So what are these seismic waves? They are the waves generated due to sudden movement, that is sudden release of energy from where? From the earth's interior, that is beneath the earth's crust, that is upper mantle. So largely most of the earthquakes happen because of this particular reason, that is the release of energy. So how do we record it? How do we measure it? So we must understand that there is something called seismograph or seismometer. So this seismograph or seismometer is that particular instrument that is used to detect and record these earthquakes. So remember these two words, seismograph or seismometer. The recorded graphical output, it means that is the output that we get from this instrument, that is called seismogram. So there is a difference between seismometer and seismogram. So remember these key terminologies here. So now let's understand the characteristic of each type of particular wave that is generated and recorded in the seismometer. So now let's understand P motion, that is P wave, is the first wave to arrive and it is recorded in the seismogram format that we generate. So generally it is smaller and higher frequency than the S and surface waves. So P waves in a liquid or gas are pressure waves, including the sound waves. So if you look into this image, you observe various expansions and compressions, and there are certain places which are undisturbed medium. So P wave is the fastest traveling wave that we need to remember. Now the next is called secondary wave or the S wave. So they do not travel as fast as P wave, as they do not travel through fluids or molten state. So there are certain layers in the earth, beneath the earth crust, like asthenosphere, which is partially molten. So what happens? These waves tend to deviate. It does not flow fast through these fluids. So what happens? S waves travel slower than the P waves. And remember, this is the second one to reach the earth just after the P wave. Now, let's understand another kind of wave that is called Love wave. So Love waves exist because of the earth's surface. So remember, it is the surface based wave. They are largest at the surface and decrease in amplitude with depth. So what happens? With depth, their amplitude decreases. So Love waves are dispersive in nature. It means that their velocity is dependent upon its frequency, with lower frequency normally propagating at higher velocity. So what happens? The depth of penetration of these Love waves is also dependent upon frequency, with lower frequencies penetrating to greater depth. So if you can look in the image, you'll find the description in place. Now, the next set of wave is called Rayleigh waves, and it is the most important wave in terms of human beings. How? Let's understand. So Rayleigh waves are also dispersive in nature, and the amplitudes generally decrease with depth in the earth. But its appearances and particle motion are similar to the water waves. As you must have observed the waves in water, it's very similar to that. So most of the shaking is felt from this Rayleigh wave. Remember, the shaking that we feel on Earth's surface in our homes, that is because of Rayleigh wave maximum times that we feel. So it can be much larger than the other waves. So that's important. Now, the emanation of energy occurs along a fault. So we'll understand what is a fault. So further, let's see. A fault is a sharp break in the crustal rocks. So what is crustal rock? The rocks that form the earth's upper layer, that is the crustal rocks. So rocks along a fault generally move in opposite directions. So if the rocks are moving away from each other, it means they are pulling away from each other. So there is a tensional force in between. Now let's understand that what is this focus and epicenter. These are another two important points or terms to remember in context to the earthquakes. So the point where this energy is released, okay, the release point, that is called focus or the hypocenter of the earthquake. So hypocenter is that point from where that wave is starting to generate, that source point. So the point on the surface directly above this focus, okay, that is called epicenter. So whenever earthquakes come, we always locate the epicenter, that where on the earth's surface has this wave hit for the first time at that particular point. So that point is referred to as epicenter. So a line connecting all these points on the surface where the intensity of the waves are same is called isosismic line. So if somebody asks you what is isosismic line, it is line that is joining all the places on the earth with same intensity of earthquakes felt. So that is what is isosismic line. Now let's understand through this diagram. As we understood that there is a focus point, there is an epicenter on the surface, and movement happens along the fault. So what do you observe here? There is a particular focus of this particular wave generation, and on the surface there is an epicenter, and it is mostly along the fault boundaries or the plate's boundaries. So next important point is the measurement factor. How do we measure these earthquakes? So these earthquakes are measured on different scales. One of them is called Mercalli scale. So it is not very common to hear Mercalli scale. Why? Let's understand. Because this scale represents the intensity and magnitude of earthquake after analyzing the after effects of the wave, that is the feeling of people about earthquake. So if more people felt it, it is supposed to be rated more on the scale. It talks about destruction post earthquake. So during the earthquake, it is not important, but post earthquake, Mercalli scale is important. And the scale ranges from 1 to 12. So it is based on 1 to 12 units. Now, the scale that is famous, that we all know, is Richter scale. So what is Richter scale? It represents the magnitude. How strong is the earthquake, right? The magnitude is expressed in absolute numbers on the scale of 10. So more the value of the earthquake on 1 to 10, more is the strong nature, more is the magnitude of this particular earthquake. So each whole number increases in Richter scale. It means that there is a tenfold increase in the power of the earthquake. So suppose if there is a value of 4 on Richter scale, and next time there is a value of 5 on Richter scale, so it's not just one unit, it's 10 times that previous earthquake in within one unit. So that is how it has to be understood when we talk about Richter scale. Now let's go to the causes of these earthquakes. What causes earthquakes? So first is the fault zones. So wherever on this crust of the earth we have faults, then that is the place where earthquakes happen. Plate tectonics, as we know, there is a movement in the earth crust's plate that is called lithospheric plates, which is lying down on the molten state that is called asthenosphere. So it tends to float on asthenosphere and keeps moving, and that's why they collide as well and they go away from each other as well. So that is about plate tectonics. Then volcanic activity. As we know that there are various zones on earth which have active volcanoes from which the magma comes out. So those areas also experience lots of earthquakes. And then there are fourth type of earthquake, that is induced by human beings' action. So those are called human induced earthquakes. So let's understand what is a fault zone. So fault zone is a place where this stress develops gradually and it releases through that weak rupture in the fault plane that we have. So that is the sudden release of stress through that fault area between the rock surfaces that are going away from each other. So that is the fault zone part. And it happens because of the change in volume and density of rocks. So remember, the factors that are responsible for this are the change in volume and density factor of the Earth's interior rocks. Then plate tectonics, as we understand that there is a movement in the plate. So normally there are two, three types of plate. So convergent, divergent, transformed boundaries. So one is moving towards each other, one is moving away from each other, and one is moving along each other. So that is important. So remember, most of the earthquakes occur at divergent boundary, where the plates are moving away from each other. Also at particular faults called reverse fault, During the convergence of two boundaries, where there is a convergence, there is a reverse fault occurrence, and that is where megathrust earthquakes also occur. And what is a megathrust earthquake? It is that earthquake which measures more than 8 or more. So that is called megathrust earthquakes. Apart from that, there are also certain zones called subduction zones. So what happens here? One plate subducts below the other one. So which is denser and faster subducts. And that's why what happens here? There is a movement which is felt as the wave is released in terms of energy. So that is another place. Now, volcanic activity, as we already know, that volcanic activity is one of the most important areas in the world where you have more frequency of the earthquakes occurring, and it is important that we understand that generally less severe and more limited in extent are the nature of the volcanic activity, because they are limited to a particular area where volcanoes are present. So next important point in this is that by the consequent release of elastic strain that accumulates, that we have learned that there is a strain that keeps accumulating beneath the volcanoes, and gradually it comes out in the form of molten magma, lava that we call. So these earthquakes serve as an important warning for the volcanic eruptions as well many times, because just before a large volcanic activity, smaller earthquakes keep coming. That is the reason why many scientists say that if there are smaller earthquakes occurring in a particular area, there may be a large earthquake coming in the near future. So that is the point why people say that if Himalayan region is experiencing lots of smaller earthquakes, it means there is a chance that a major earthquake may occur. Only because of this factor, but it is not common in other fault zone areas. It is mostly common in volcanic areas. So human-induced earthquake are other types of earthquake. Why and how it is done? Through human activities. What kind of human activities? Mining, large-scale extraction of petroleum, artificial lakes creation, nuclear tests. So these are certain activities through which human beings also induce these earthquakes. So example in India is 6.3 magnitude 1967 Koyna Nagar earthquake. That happened because of the Koyna Dam reservoir, and that is one of the most important example in Indian context when we talk about human induced earthquakes. It took life of almost 150 people at that time. So the other classification involves these five types. One is tectonic, one is volcanic, one is collapse, that is mining activity, roof collapses, and then explosion based earthquakes and reservoir induced earthquakes. So these are the five major classification types. And then let's look at the distribution of these earthquakes. So if we look at distribution of the earthquakes, about 68% of all earthquakes occur along Pacific Ring of Fire. Why? As we know that Pacific Ring of Fire, that is the circum-Pacific belt, has most of the volcanic areas and subduction zone. So as we know the factors responsible for the earthquakes, it's all available there. So almost 2/3 of the earthquake occur along circum-Pacific belt. The areas include New Zealand, New Guinea, Japan, Aleutian Islands, Alaska, western coast of North and South America. These are particular areas where maximum earthquakes occur. But what about Himalayan belt? What about Alps? 15% of the world's total earthquakes occur in our mountain ranges, that is Himalaya and Alps. So this is the distribution map, and if you want to learn this distribution map, just take a map of the major faults of the earth or the plate boundaries of the earth. This map is exactly similar to those fault map of the world or the plate boundaries of the world. So if you want to learn it, practice with the major plate boundaries, and you'll find that all the plate boundaries margins are occupied with number of these kinds of occurrences of earthquakes. So that's the best way to learn. And this is the chart. You can pause the video and look at each one of them. This is the top 10 earthquake in last 100 years. So now when we have learned about the details of earthquake, how it occurs, what are the important factors, I hope all your confusion is cleared. And if you have any more further queries, please feel free to write in the comment box below, and I'll come back with more facts and more answers for you. So all the best wishes. Take care.